So I'm going to talk about a study with colleagues here at ICTP, Riccardo Farnetti and Frank Kukarski, and Tim Stockdale at TCMWF. It's a bit strange for a talk on decadal variability given by a person from an institution that doesn't do decadal studies by mandate, but of course we do a number of things which are related. So my idea was to see whether we could say something about the decadal variability from basically what we do at TCMWF. We do reanalysis and we do seasonal predictions and longer sets of reforecasts. So just a few slides to start, just to summarize where we started from. And of course, you know, these things have already been discussed, some of them just in the past couple of talks, so there's no need to spend too much time. So we have discussed the hiatus in global mean temperature, and so first of all we can look at it in terms of the decline in the trend of annual mean, global mean temperature. And for example, if you use the Halley Center, the HAD-CRUT4 data set from the IPCC report, you can quote a trend of about 0.26 degrees per decade from 84 to 98, and almost flattening in the following 15 years. However, it's also been reported that this hiatus has a seasonality. You see much stronger if you actually look at the Northern Hemisphere winter. For example, if you look at the picture on the left-hand side, from Trenenberg et al. In Nature Climate Change, you can actually see that actually if you look at the basically the cold season in the Northern Hemisphere, you actually have a slightly negative trend in surface temperature. And even more so if you concentrate on what happens in the Northern Extratropics, then the decrease is even stronger. Now, we have heard a lot of discussions about the role of the PDO or IPO, and in particular you've heard from Dr. Kosaka about this very nice pacemaker experiments which have actually shown a very good reproduction of these trends. And one thing that perhaps she didn't mention was the fact that not only in this paper they managed to reproduce a lot of the pattern and the overall amplitude, but also they managed to reproduce at least part of this seasonality, with again, you know, the strongest hiatus being during the northern winter. However, if you actually look at the observations, you can actually see that the seasonality is even stronger than what is actually simulated in this particular experiment. And if you look, for example, at regional levels, you can actually see some discrepancies, which of course you may expect because of the chaotic nature of the response in the extratropics. So one question is there a missing ingredient in simulating this seasonality? And if you actually think about the global energy budget, so at the surface, and you do an annual mean, for example, this is a result from ERA interim, then of course what is very noticeable is that the regions where the ocean loses heat to the atmosphere are mainly concentrated in the regions of basically the western side of the ocean, the regions on the western boundary currents, and this actually loss of heat mainly occurs during the northern winter. So a related question is, what is the role of the variability in this region in actually modulating the changes in near surface temperature? So, as I said, we don't do decadal simulation at TCMWF, but we produce reanalysis. So, I looked at some data from the ERA interim reanalysis that now covers the period from 1979 onwards. And then I looked at the set of reforecast that we use to calibrate our seasonal forecast system. The latest version is called System 4. And to calibrate this seasonal forecast, we have done reforecast every month starting from January 1981, and you can then add the operational forecast and have a sort of continuous set. In particular, for if you consider the December, January, and February season, we have runs from the 1st of November. In this case, you know, the DJF season will correspond to forecast months 2 to 4. And for these, we have 51 member ensembles in the reforecast. So it's quite a large set. And basically, we used it to estimate the internal variability arising from basically the internal spread within these ensembles. And you know, we have sufficiently long records, so we can cover basically the latest transition to the hiatus. So we computed trends, and we tried, since of course there's the issue of where actually you put the limits of your trend, and the issue is that if you put it in 98, as many people do, then it's really the year of a very strong El Nino. So you may really get very large numbers or very small numbers simply because you start from an El Nino year. You get a more consistent estimate of trends if you actually run a five-year running mean over the temperature first, which is roughly the main period of an ENSO cycle. And so you get something which is more related, in fact, to these decadal modes. So we computed these trends from various quantities that you will see from 84 to 98, and then from 98 to 2011 in various areas, basically an area just excluding the polar cap, 70 south to 70 north, the tropical belt, 20 to 20, and the northern extratropics in various regions. Now, the first thing I wanted to check is this. If we make the hypothesis that the main contribution to the hiatus comes from this basically natural internal variability of the climate system, you know, including the PDO, including other possible, then a main contribution will come basically from the heat transfer, a reduction in the heat transfer from the ocean to the atmosphere. So if you now take the era interim fluxes, and you actually plot basically the net heat flux into the atmosphere, which would be basically a sum of latent and sensible heat, the upwelling long wave radiation from the surface, and the absorption of solar radiation, which actually doesn't play a very big role in winter, then can we see a hiatus? And the answer is yes, we can see it. These are plots starting from 1980. The red dots are individual yearly means, and the blue dots are five-year running means. And so you can clearly see that there's much stronger positive trend in the fluxes. Correspond about 3 watts per meter square per decade. And after 1998, this flattens to about 0.6 watts per square meter per decade. And if you convert these numbers into some temperature trends using a simple, basically, radiative equilibrium hypothesis, then you get numbers which are not very far from these estimates that, from the HADCOOT data. So there's a consistency between the fluxes and the observed surface temperature. Now, these are yearly means. If you look at what happens during the northern winter, DJF, this again 70 north to 70 south, and then you can actually see that consistently with the temperature record, the trend in the fluxes is actually becoming slightly negative in the last 15 years. Okay, then you can ask where is this signal coming from, and you can actually compare these two regions, which have roughly the equal geographical size, you know, the tropics 20 north to 20 south, and the northern extratropics 20 north to 70 north. And again, you can look at the total heat into the atmosphere from the tropics, and again, you see the hiatus. Obviously, you know, it's the effect of the decadal variability in the tropical Pacific. But if you actually look in the northern extratropics, then you see a much stronger signal, almost a complete flattening of the heating into the atmosphere. And okay, to cut the story short, you can actually find out that most of these signals come from the latent and sensible heat. And what we know is that latent and sensible heat are strongly modulated by the circulation, by the wind intensity of the winds, and by the capacity of the northern circulation to advect cold air over warm ocean during winter. So we wanted to explore this particular aspect, and a few years ago we tried to link basically the observational definition that Mike Wallace and collaborators gave of the so-called cold ocean warm land pattern, which is basically a wave number two pattern that brings warm air over the continents during winter, with the prediction from thermal equilibration theory, which has been discussed by a number of authors. And basically, what this theory says is that you can have basically two states of this wave number two pattern. In one phase, you actually have the highs over the ocean, and therefore you reduce the heat exchanges, and you have basically the atmosphere equilibrating to the surface temperature contrast, or a force mode, which is actually this one, where you actually have a strong advection of cold air over the warm ocean, you extract a lot of heat from the ocean, and then this heat is actually advected over the continent. So we define this scale pattern actually using the wave number two component of the net surface heat flux in this way. Basically, is the net flux out of the ocean in this region minus the flux into the land over the continent. And if you actually look at the time series of this particular index over this last 35 years, you actually see that in the last 10, 15 years there's been a downward trend. So we wanted to see whether this was actually related to the hiatus. So we first look at how this pattern was simulated in the System 4 model. And okay, so we computed covariances of this index with a number of variables, and in particular you can see, for example, there's intensification of near surface winds over the northern ocean. This extracts more latent and sensible heat flux, and then this actually turns into warm anomalies over the northern continents. So then what we said is, okay, don't probably worry too much about the details. Now, we have this index. We can compute it from each ensemble member every year. We have 51 ensemble members. And then we can somehow compose it. In this case, it's actually a weighted average. Basically, those members which have a very good representation of the variability of this particular index, and those who actually have a very poor representation of this particular index. In particular, ensemble members that do not simulate the variability of the curve pattern. And then we can construct ensemble means from these weighted averages, and we compare what comes out in terms of, for example, surface temperature. And this is what happens. So you see here in red dots the time series of the observed Kaul index that you have seen. And in green is the time series of the index from the ensemble that reproduces the analysis. It's called NSA, and you see that it fits quite well with the red dots. And then we have this N0, which is basically an ensemble that doesn't reproduce almost at all the variability in this. Now, since these are seasonal forecasts that are actually initialized with the same SST, in the first few months, the SST don't change very much. So if you actually look at, for example, some El Niño indices, these are almost identical between the two ensembles. So these two ensembles have basically the same SST in the tropics. So what they differ is simply the response in the extratropic. In one case, you get the response similar to what has happened. In the other case, you have a near zero response. Now, let's look now at the 2 meter temperature over the northern hemisphere in these two ensembles. We plot the two curves. So you can see that the strong increase before 98 is well reproduced in both ensembles. And then you see a decrease, again, in both ensembles. But if you actually look at the black curve, where there is no extratropical variability, you actually have, I would say, a flattening of the temperature. If you actually compute a trend from the one that has the right variability, it actually has a decreasing trend. And in fact, if you plot the difference, you can see that just the difference in the extratropical response accounts for a decrease, basically a negative temperature trend over the northern extratropics, so of about 0.1 degree per decade. So we have talked about this missing 0.2 degrees overall on a global scale. If you actually concentrate on the northern hemisphere in winter, about 0.1, so half of that, can be explained by the extratropical signal. And in fact, this estimate fits quite well with an recent estimate by Saffiotti et al. And he's here in the audience, so I think he will talk about this probably tomorrow. Now, the interesting thing is that, well, it's interesting to look at these integrated quantities, but what about the regional effects? And the regional effects are, in fact, quite strong over the land. So this is the change in the circulation between basically the beginning and the end of the last 15-year period. This is the change in geopotential height from the reanalysis. This is the difference in the trend between, let's say, the good ensemble and the bad ensemble. Again, remember, these are the same, almost the same SST. They only change in terms of extratropical variability. This is the difference in 2 meter temperature at the global level. You see this very strong warming actually over the Arctic, but in general quite a strong cooling over the northern continents. And in fact, if you just average, for example, over Europe, you get actually a cooling of 0.34 degrees. Now, if you look at the pattern which is attributable to the change in this wave number two component, then you see that this continental cooling is pretty well simulated, and in fact, for example, if you concentrate here over Europe, you see that the ensemble with the correct variability reproduces a cooling of 0.49 centigrade. The ensemble with no variability in this wave number two actually gives a slight warming of 0.21. So at the regional level, there's a very strong difference. Now, I think not directly related to the pattern, but another interesting feedback may be in terms of the feedback on the ocean circulation. And we've actually seen that the ensemble with the correct extratropical variability actually simulates a response in terms of near surface winds over the Pacific that tend to actually slow down the gyre circulation and therefore the subtropical circulation. So this may actually be relevant for the mechanism that Ricardo described in his earlier talk about the possibility of a feedback of the extratropical response onto the PDO itself. Okay? So coming to conclusions. So although the recent reduction in global warming trends can be detected in both the tropics and the extratropics, the seasonality, which is strongest in the DJF season, if you actually trust the ERA interim fluxes, you come to the conclusion that it's mostly originated in the northern extratropics. There is still a component from the tropics, but the fact that it's so strong during winter, to explain it, you have to take into account what happens in the extratropics. So we have seen that changes in the phase of this wave number two cowl pattern and the associated heat flux anomaly gave a significant contribution to the slowdown in northern hemisphere warming trends during the winter of the last 15 years. It's mainly over land, and basically by subsampling the different members in the ECMWF System 4 reforecast, which have basically the same tropical SST anomaly and very, very similar also extratropical SST, but by construction differ in terms of strong or weak cowl variability, then we can account for about 0.1 degree per decade in the IATO. So it's about half of what you actually need to explain. And we have also seen this possible feedback on the wind circulation that we are going to explore in the future. Thank you.